Hi everyone. Yeah, any questions for me? The last. Oh, okay. Okay, you guys have no questions, right? All right then, okay. So, I hope you guys got time to work on the Hibernate last time. Okay.
Arun, I was trying to run the Hibernate program and I was getting errors like the log4j jar has not been appended properly or something, so it wasn't working.
Did you add all the jar files which I gave you?
Yes.
Both the set of jar files, right? Are you trying the annotations one or not the other one?
Both of them, the annotations and the jar files outside of the annotations.
Okay, but still you have the concern that it's log4j not appended, right?
Yes.
I don't think you see. Was it a warning?
It
So
was a
now.
warning, and then when I was trying to look at after the warning, I was getting exception messages as well. Like when I was trying to get all data using the servlet, I was getting null pointer exception. So.
Using the servlet you are trying to get, or you are trying to combine servlet
I'm sorry, not the servlet, the main program,
Hibernate
just
together.
the standalone application.
So what do you remember the exception message?
When I was using the program to extract all data, like the one you had written, basically I had just copied it, and so it was trying to extract the employees, and I was getting a null pointer exception when I was trying to print employee.id. So it wasn't returning employee, and I tried checking in the database. It had not made created any table by the name of tEmployee.
Okay. See, the thing is, if you did you upload the XML file hibernate.cfg? Did you change from
Yes.
did you change from create to update?
From what to update?
See, do you remember? Okay, yesterday we were talking about hibernate.cfg. In hibernate.cfg file, there is an option. But when you are running it for the very first time, you could have created, you have the option called create here, right? And what happens is, I told you that if you use create, table exists, and if the table is existing, it will drop and creates a new table, right? So if it is dropping and creating a new table,
I just copied the latest file that you had given, so I'm not sure
no.
whether it had.
Yeah. So this is what I think the problem was, because if you have the option as a create over here, what exactly happens is it will destroy the table and try to create a new one. When it creates a new one,
Okay.
you won't be having any records to retrieve, right?
Right.
That
Okay.
could be the problem.
So
Anyhow, once we are done with the class, I'll look into it. But I
okay.
think this is what the problem you might be coming across.
So I should be putting it as update instead of create.
Yeah, if you do it as an update, if the table do not exist, it creates a new one. If the table
Okay.
already exists, it modifies the table.
Okay. I'll do that then.
Let's see. Alright. Suman, I have seen your email. Okay. I try to base my class today on that. Otherwise, I'll help you out differently. Yeah, I'll see that. Dana, what exactly the question? I didn't get you about the jar files.
Yeah,
go ahead.
Yeah, the jar files which you send for MySQL also, or it's for Oracle?
I completely gave the set of jar files which also include, see, the jar files will not be specific to the databases. The jar files are independent of database. So,
okay.
And one of the jar files is MySQL connector. See,
okay.
I gave you a list of jar files, right?
Yeah.
Now in that list of jar files, so these jar files are not specific to the database. Jar files will never be any specific to a database. Okay.
Oh, okay.
So here, what you need to do is, instead of using OJDBC 14, you should use MySQL character in the build part.
Okay.
That's it. There is there is nothing new you need to do for connecting to MySQL. Of course, there will be a change in the XML file. In the XML file, you need to change these values.
Okay.
That's it. Then you can connect to any database.
Okay. And one more question around the property names which you are giving, like this hypernet.connection.something, no? Is that the exact name we need to give, or we need to give?
The property names must be same what you have here.
Okay.
It's
like a syntax?
Yeah, you can say this is a syntax.
Okay.
See, what exactly happens is, whenever you run your program, right, whenever you do this, session factory dot, we are doing this stuff, right? New configuration dot, configure dot, build session factory. Then it will try to read this XML document, and in the XML document it tries to read property tag name values.
Okay.
That's how they do it. So it is must that they should be the same. If you change it, then if you want to change, then you should develop your own framework.
Oh, okay.
Otherwise you need to stick to the same property names. You cannot write anything of your choice.
Okay, Aaron. Okay, thank you.
So guys, if you remember, yesterday we... Oh, see, jar files will remain same, Anand. But the only concern will be, whether will you be able to run database or not. One of the database should be installed on your machine. Either Oracle or MySQL or any Derby database. Right, something should be available. If any database should be available, and you can use the same set of jar files to connect to any database. Alright guys, now here we go. If you remember, last day I was struggling with the annotations one. I'll tell you the reason for it. The reason was jars conflict. Means, when I did right click and I'm trying to do build path, configure build path, there was one jar file called hibernate3. Now instead of hibernate3, I'm using a hibernate.jar from annotations folder. See, I was using this yesterday. Instead, I removed this. I'm using this, and that solved the problem. So it was not a big technical problem there. It was only a jar conflict, right? So I added the right jar file. The problem has been resolved for me. Okay. So I was using the annotations. I hope you might have understood by this time what is the significance of annotations. instead of using XML file for mapping, I'm using the annotations for mapping. So here this is how I specify that, okay, this is an entity and this is the table name I want to map to. And ID, this is the primary key, auto generator and the column name. Here we go. For other fields, column only. Only for the primary key you will be doing this. For rest of the fields, only annotation is column. That's it. I'm done. Then there is no change in the program. As I said, right? There is the only problem was a jar conflict. Yeah, it got records. Okay, let me do something. Look, guys, I already have a table. I'm changing this XML configuration to create. Then I run this code. Now you see what happens. Now there is only one record in the table. Why there is only one record? What about your previous table? It got destroyed. Your previous table got destroyed. The reason being you have written the option create. What is the significance of create option? If the table exists, it destroys the table and creates a new one. So what happened? Your existing table was destroyed and a new table was created and a record is added to it. So next time when you want to run, now I want to retry the records. Now when I want to require the records, when I want to retry the records, here if I put create, what happens? Again it destroys the table and tries to create a new one. So I switch from create to update. Now I will be demonstrating this get employee. Guys, focus here. I'll be showing a lot of options in this example. So here we go. Now what is happening? You are using annotation. So what is that you are using? New annotation configuration dot configure. Now normally if it is no annotation, if you are not using annotation, this is what you do. But since you are using annotation, this is what? New annotation configuration. And one more thing is, in the XML file, If you are using a mapping XML, you will be writing mapping resource here. You won't be writing a class attribute, you will be writing a resource attribute. But what I am using now, I am not using XML for mapping, I am using annotations for mapping. I am using annotations for mapping. So here it changes from resource attribute to class attribute. It changes from resource attribute to class attribute. Now here we go. So what happened here? Session dot create query from employee. Session dot create query from employee. So on the session object, you are invoking a method create query. But look at the way you constructed the query. This is not your SQL. This is not SQL. It is HQL. What do you mean by HQL? Hibernate Query Language. Hibernate Query Language. Because if you see, what is your table name in the here? Your table name is t_employee. If it is your SQL, you say from table name. But here I said from employee. Now what is employee here? The class name. So you said from employee. Then you did query dot list. That's it. From employee in the sense, you get all the records from the table. Right. So query dot list. So you retrieve everything and you assign it to a list and you print it. This is like get all. Right. If you remember, you go back to one of these programs and you see what you have written, the amount of code you have written for retrieving all the records. The amount of code you have written for retrieving all the records. So this is get all. So first you see the number of lines you have written. It's almost how many lines? 174. Yeah, almost 30 lines of code you have written. Now you observe what is happening. It's a single line. Your job is done. And you are printing it. And you are printing it. The select query executed and you got the data here. And this we discussed last day also. So I'm commenting this out now. Let me demonstrate one more thing. I'm using Hibernate Query Language. Now if you observe this program, normally if it is SQL, what will you do? Select star from employee where employee ID equal to question mark. But in Hibernate, this is what you do. In Hibernate, this is what you do. From employee, E, what is E? E is an alias name to employee. E dot ID is employee ID. Guys, understand? Employee is what? Employee is a class name. What is E? E is a reference name for the class. What is the variable name ID? So where E dot ID, and this is like question mark. This is like question mark. Then for that question mark, you set the parameter. Query dot set parameter. What is the parameter name? Employee ID. And what is the value you are passing? 1. Because what is the record you have? 1. Then query dot list. You still say query dot list. And you know that you get only 1 record. And you are printing it. See, EID equal to question mark. I hope it's clear. Let me discuss the other part. Now what I am doing here, select name. Understand, here I am not saying, it is still HQL. It is still HQL, Hibernate Query Language. But you are not getting all the columns, you are getting only what? Name column. You are fetching only what? Name column. And you did query.list. But this time, look at this, earlier, you did from employee. You did from employee. You are fetching all the columns. So, when you say query.list, you are assigning it to what? List of employees. But now in this regard, what are you doing? You are getting only name. You are getting only name. So since you are getting only name, you are assigning it to what? List of string. Perfect. What next? If you try to get more than one column, if you get all the columns, if you get all the columns, if you get all the columns, it is a list of employee. If you get single column, it is list of the data type. Because you are fetching the name, it is list of string. If you fetch salary, it will be list of double. Right? But in case if you try to fetch two columns, you are fetching name as well as salary. You are fetching name as well as salary. Now in this case, look what it is. It is list of object array. It is list of object array. And each time you get an object array, and from that object array you are printing, array of 0 is name, array of 1 is salary. It's name, it's salary. Why? Because the first column name is name, the second column name is salary. So I discussed all the possibilities of your Hibernate query language. Now, you guys have any questions before I move further? Or you want me to try something else? I mean, I showed you different possibilities, and if you have any questions, you can let me know. Where are we giving database connection? You still have your Hibernate CFG. Only you are replacing the mapping file with annotation. Only you are replacing the mapping file with annotation. See, in the last example, there were two XML files. One is your configuration XML file. Other is your mapping XML file. Now when you use annotations, you are replacing annotation XML file with, you are replacing annotation XML, mapping XML file with annotation. Mapping XML file is replaced with annotation, not your Hibernate CFG. You still have your Hibernate CFG that is responsible for database connections. You still have your Hibernate.cfg that is responsible for database connections. Only the mapping file is replaced with, you are doing the mapping with the help of annotations instead of XML. I hope your question is answered, Suman. Now, okay, which typecasting you are talking about, Dana? Which line number you are talking about? Oh, here. because I'm just printing the data, then why do I need to typecast? If I want to do something, then I need a typecasting, right? If you are talking about this, right? Because I have different, I have one is string and other one is what? Double. I'm retaining it as an object array, whereas array of 0 is holding the string, array of 1 is holding the double. I'm just printing it, so I'm not typecasting it. In case if I want to do something, I'm going to come to it, Suman, right? I'm going to come to mapping things. Okay, then it's your one. I'm just printing the data, so I'm not typecasting it, right? If I want to if I want to do some operations, then of course I need to do typecasting. Here I'm not typecasting. I'm not doing typecasting because I'm not doing any operations with this data. I'm just printing it. Now I cannot assign it to a string variable like this. If I want to assign this value to a string variable, then of course I need to typecast it and assign it to a string variable. Alright guys, so this is all about Hibernate query language, and you don't get anything complicated than this. So you can just look at those examples and keep working on more and more stuff. Yeah, now I want to write my SQL query. I want to write my native SQL. I don't want to make use of Hibernate query language. I don't want to learn something new. I just want to use my regular SQL. So look, if you look at the employee.java, what is the table name? T_employee. What is the column name? EID, ename and eSalary. Right? Now look at this. I'm not doing, earlier I did session.createQuery. Now I'm doing what? Session.createSQL query. Session.createSQL query. So what is the query you are writing? It's your regular SQL, normal SQL. So let's start from T_employee. T_employee is a table name. Now, perfect. So what we are doing here, look at the line number 68, this got the significance here. SQL query dot add entity employee dot class. You are trying to fetch all the columns, right? Select star. So when you are fetching, where that data should sit into, means when you say select star from T_employee, you are fetching all the columns. And what? Each row represent a employee record, right? So you are saying add entity, that is, look at this, when you get SQL query dot list, you are assigning it to list of employees. When you get SQL query dot list, you are assigning it to what? List of employees. How come you can assign it to list of employees? Because in the line number 68, you specified that each record is going to be of employee type. That's the reason, and the rest of the story is same, familiar story. The only line which is new is this, and here you are not writing Hibernate query, you are writing your SQL query, structured query. Now, so all the previous options I'm going to discuss with SQL here. All the Hibernate query language options I'm discussing with SQL here. Session.createSQL query. Select star from table name where employee ID equal to question mark. Then for that question mark you are setting the parameter. But here you need to focus. Normally these are called positional parameters. The question marks are called positional parameters. Now if you remember JDBC, positional parameters starts with 1 in JDBC, whereas in Hibernate in Hibernate starts with 0. That is a problem. Right. I spent a lot of time to realize this actually. I was passing one, I was struggling, I didn't understand. Then I went back and started reading the documentation of the Hibernate. Then I realized that, oh, here the positional parameter starts with 0. There is only one question mark, right? So I was trying to pass one here. Then I had a problem. So then I realized it after reading. Then I started passing 0, 0. This is your first question mark. So your count is starting with 0. Then the rest is same. Add entity and
done.
Next. Now this time you are trying to read only one column. You are trying to read only one column. So you are passing the value for the question mark. But now this time you are not saying add entity. You are saying add scalar. You are not saying add entity. You are saying add scalar. You are not saying add entity. You are saying add scalar. Why are we calling it as add scalar? Because you have only one column. When you go for add entity, when you are trying to fetch all the columns, when you go for add entity. But you are trying to fetch only single column. So you said add scalar. And you are assigning it to an array list of string type. You are assigning it to an array list of string type. Perfect. Then comes the interesting part. Look at this one. Now you are trying to fetch what? More than one column, but not all the columns. You are trying to fetch more than one column, but not all the columns. So for the positional parameter, you are setting the value. Then you are not calling add entity, you are not calling add scalar. You are not calling add entity, you are not calling add scalar. Instead, you are using what? You are saying set result transformer. Set result transformer and you pass it some constant. What is a constant? Map. So when you did query.list, it returns on a list and you are reading one item from a list and each item is typecasted to what? Map. So if you remember the previous one, it was an object array. Each item is what? Object array. Now here, instead of object array, each record, I'm making it as a map. And what I'm doing? Each record, I'm treating it as a map. Then I'm saying here, get the keys of the map. And get the keys of the map. Otherwise, let's not make it complicated for you. Okay, let me make it very simple. Slow. Map dot get off. Key name. Map dot get off. So your column names acts like a keys. Your column names acts like a keys. E salary, Y caps. Your column names are acting like a keys. You get a map and each map stores the data in the form of key value. Key becomes the column name, value, the values of the data become the value. You are trying to print it. There is only one record. If you have multiple records, the for loop repeats. every time the for loop repeats, it is treated as single record. Right? Every time a loop repeats, it's a record. And you're typecasting it to map, and from the map you're fetching the data. And providing column names as a keys. Providing column names as a keys. So any questions on this part, or is it simple? Alright, then I assume that you guys have, okay. Oh, when you have, see, if more than one employee is sharing the same ID, that's the reason if you remember what I'm doing here. I'm doing it as query.list. Though you have multiple records with the same ID, doesn't matter, right? You are doing any of this. It's returning an array list of items. So you have a map. Okay, you want to see that, right? So let me do it. Let me add one more record. Perfect. Let me go back and say get employees. Run it. Oh, what happened? Yeah, there are two records. Oh, here you said ID equal to question mark, right? Okay, fine. You wanna see this part, right? Without this. There are two records. So each map is one record. So this list will have two maps. The first map for first record, the second map for second record. Did you got the answer? So you still have a question? Oh, you can see. You can pass only one value for this question mark at a given point of time, right? How can you pass two values for that question mark? At a given point of time, you try to fetch, okay. Now what you can do is, this value you can pass dynamically. Now I am reading it from a keyboard. Okay, look. Let me do this for you. Scanner. System.in. Enter ID. Scanner.next. Get employee. Enter ID. 1. Get the record. Run it again. Enter ID. 2. Fetch the record. Okay. Alright guys. If no questions, let me move on to very interesting thing of Hibernate. Mappings. Okay. Now before I go to the mapping, why do we need this mapping part actually? Yeah. I have something like this. Employee. I have an employee ID. Name of the employee. Salary of the employee. Door number. Street. City. select zip code. Perfect. One, Arun, door number, street, city, perfect. Now let me add one more, Kiran. Now, can you people suggest me what is good? Is it good to write address, maintain address in the same table, or is it good to maintain address in a different table? Okay, I'll make it very clear for you. You can just take some guesses, wild guesses regarding this. So, is this what recommended? Tell me which is a good practice. The first one is a good practice, or the second thing is a good practice. Alright, you should also give a reason for it. You just need to, you cannot simply say, okay, this is good and this is bad. Okay, maybe, but I'm not worried. I'm not looking with respect, with perspective of your idea. I mean, as you said, personal records should be keep in subject. Maybe correct, but I agree with your point. But in this regard, what exactly I'm trying to say, I don't want to get into that security or reason for it. Right? So tell me now, why, what is good? Is this the first implementation good and second implementation good? And here I'll add a constraint. Every customer has a unique address, or every customer has a unique and one, only one address. Every customer has a unique and only one address, and in simple I'll say it's 1-to-1. A customer can have only one address. Which practice is good? Is the first one, or is the second one? Is this the right way of doing the things? Or is this the right way of doing the things for 1-to-1? For 1-to-1, which is the right way of doing things? The first one or second one? So here, now assume that you are following this because it is easy for us to do the things. Assume that you are following this. You are following the first approach. Assume that you are following the first approach. If you are following the first approach, that is something, that is a good approach also. Why? Because you don't need to run behind two tables. You just fetch the data from one table, you insert the data into one table. You don't need to work on two different tables. You can simply work on a single table. Your data retrieval is quicker. Your data retrieval is quicker, and your job gets done very quickly. And you don't need to bang your brain to understand how to get the data from two different tables, because everything is in a single table. So as a person, because it's simplifying my things, I go with the first solution. So today is my business requirement is every customer can have only unique address, and it can have only one address. But if you might have observed these shopping portals, online shopping portals, what is happening? They allow more than one address per customer. They allow more than one address per customer. Take any shopping portal, they allow more than one customer, one address per shopping, I mean one address per customer. So initially their business requirement was for one customer, one address. Initially their requirement was for one customer, one address. Now their requirement changed. For one customer, there can be many addresses. So will my first solution work? Now they said that, hey, a customer can have multiple addresses. Then what happens in this case? I'm duplicating what? I'm duplicating the customer data. So I hope you understood. What is the drawback of your first solution? The drawback of your first solution is, as long as it is one to one, as long as it is one to one, no complaints. Everything goes well and everything goes well very efficiently. The problem starts when my business requirement switches from one to one to one to many. When my business requirement changes from one to one, or we can say many to one. One to one to one to many. My business requirement changes from one to one to one to many. I said one customer can have many addresses. Here you are duplicating the data. So the first solution is not the right solution. My second solution is the best. Why? Because look at this. I'm not duplicating the employee details. How happily I'm able to do this. So this is scalable. If you split the data into two different tables, it is scalable. Now today it is one to one. Tomorrow it can change from one. It can change to one to many. It can change to one to many. Whereas if you follow the first approach, it will be one to one. If you want to switch from one to one, if you want to switch from one to one to one to many, then you have to change your design completely. You have to change your implementations completely. You have to change your design, you have to change your implementation. But if you might have observed, if you might have followed the second approach, no change in design needed, no change in implementations needed, the only change is needed in the database. Here you will have earlier you had a unique constraint. If it is a one to one, if it is a one-to-one, EID will be unique. If it is one-to-many, if it is one-to-many, hey, which EID? EID in address is unique. If it is one-to-many, EID in address is not unique now. I hope it's clear for you why, what is the need to go for two different tables when you have one-to-one cardinality. When you have one-to-one cardinality, why are we going for two tables? Because if you go for two tables, you can happily switch to one-to-many in the future without changing any design and without changing any implementation. But if you go for single table, in the future you have to switch, you cannot switch to one-to-many. Then you need to destroy everything what you have, then you need to rebuild it. Is this clear? Or any questions on this part? Fine. Look at this example. I'm demonstrating one to one or many to one. I'm demonstrating one to one or many to one. I have a employee.java and I have a address.java. First let me show you the address.java. What do you see in address.java? As usual, entity and a table name and address ID, ID generated value column, door number, street, city, state, zip code. So one employee having one address here, @ entity, @ table, now it is employee, employee ID, ID generated value column, and here is where you need to focus. Observe here. What is that I am using? @ 1-to-1. What is that I am using? @ 1-to-1. So, a employee has an address. So, inside an employee class, you are declaring a variable of type address. Inside an employee class, you are declaring a variable of type address. You're declaring a variable of type address, then you set @ 1-to-1, right? On top of the get address method. On top of get address method, you did @ 1-to-1. Perfect. CFD.xml. Observe here what I'm doing. It's 1-to-1. What is that mapping? 1-to-1. Now, here we go. Address object. I created one address object. And I'm creating employee object. And that employee resides in the address. I'm associating address with the employee. I created another employee object, then I associated address with the employee. So guys, understand here. Here I said 1-to-1. Here I said 1-to-1. But here what I'm doing? I got two employees sharing the same address. I have two employees sharing the same address. Right? So let's see what happens. Oh, okay, got it. I missed out one more. Yeah, you see an exception here. I just want you to read this exception. Object refers an unsaved transient instance, that is, what is happening is, for this example, this is how it works. For this example, there is an employee table and there is an address table. In the address table, you have an address ID, door number, street, city, state, zip code. For employee, you have an employee ID, employee name, and what? Address ID. So address ID of the address table is a foreign key in employee table. Address ID of the address table, 1-to-1 example. Address ID of the address table is a foreign key in employee table. And you all know well that if the address is not existing, will I be able to insert that employee? I reiterate my question. If address is not existing, if address is not existing, will I be able to, suppose here if I want to insert a record, if I want to insert a record, there should be an address ID. And what is address ID here? It's a foreign key. And this foreign key must exist in the parent key, right? So without the entry in the address table, how can a student employee exist? Some address should exist here. Then only I can insert employee. So that is what problem here. I'm trying to save employee. I'm trying to save employee. But before I save the employee, I should save the address. Before I save the employee, I should save the address. So let me do this. Session.saveAddress. Session.saveAddress. Look at this. Done. Right. So here there is a problem. The problem was, there is only one address I associated with two employees. One address I'm associating with what? There is one address I'm associating with two employees. I saved the address, then I saved the employees. And there is one address being shared by two employees. Look at this. Select star from, what is the table names I have here? P_employee. P_address. Select star from P_employee. There are two employees sharing the same address ID. Address ID 1, address ID 1. Two employees are sharing the same ID. But what did I say? I said that it's a one-to-one. Every employee should have a unique address and every employee can have only one address. What do you mean by one-to-one? Every employee should have a unique address and every employee can have only one and only one address. Here every employee is having one and only one address only. But there are two employees sharing the same address. There are two employees sharing the same address over here. There are two employees sharing the same address. But how come it is one-to-one? It is not one-to-one there. It is not one-to-one. It is many-to-one. Many people are sharing the same address. It is not one-to-one. It's many-to-one. So what we should do is, in this case, we should do this. @join_column. What is the join column name? This is the join column name. And I said unique equal to true. Who is the join column here? This is the join column. Address ID in the employee table is a join column. Then I declared this join column as what? Unique. I declared a join column as what? Unique. Now I run this. You observe. You have an exception. What is the exception you have? It says unique constraint violated. I hope you understood. Though you write one to one, it is behaving like a one to many, it is behaving like a many to one. Though you mention one to one, it is behaving like a many to one. In order to stop it, you need to do this. @join_column, make the join column as a unit. Then it stops. Then it will be one to one. So understand this. This is something which is very, very important to understand. If you just write one-to-one, it doesn't make it as a one-to-one. It still behaves like a many-to-one. In order to make it as one-to-one, you need to do this. @join_column and the column name, and you just make the column as a unit. And then it starts behaving like a one-to-one. And one more stuff is, you are saving address and then saving employees. So we have option. Instead of saving address and saving employees, I can use cascade. Look, there is something called cascade equal to cascade type dot all. There is something called cascade equal to cascade type dot all. Right. There is something called cascade equal to cascade type dot all. And you guys observe, I'm not saving address. I'm not saving address, but still I succeed in saving the address. See, first I saved address, then I saved employees. So instead of you explicitly calling save address and then saving the employees, if you just specify here cascade equal to cascade type dot all, when you are saving employee, when you are saving employee, it ensures that address is also saved. It ensures that address is also saved. Now, imagine if you don't do this, what happens? You don't do this and you are not saving the address. Then you end up in an exception saying that you are referring to address which is not existing. You are referring to an unsaved transient object. So you didn't save address, but you are trying to save employees. But alright, so you have two options. Either you explicitly call save to save the address, or you can simply go here and say cascade equal to cascade type dot all, and that solves the problem for you. Alright. So this is 1-to-1. Now in case if you want many-to-1, simple. Use annotation many-to-1. Use annotation many-to-1. And it behaves like many-to-1 only. I told you earlier also, 1-to-1, if you don't specify join column, 1-to-1, if you don't specify join column, it acts like many-to-1 only. Right? But we also have a separate annotation for many-to-1. You can use this. Yeah. Any questions on this part? Or is it good? Now you see, you don't need to run insert queries on both the tables. You just run the insert, you just call the save on employee. Automatically address also gets inserted if you write cascade. If you don't write cascade, then you need to explicitly call save address. Yeah, any questions on this, or is it simple? Okay, then let me demonstrate retrieving the records also. Here I change the configuration from create to update. You just need to focus on one of the things. It is very easy. It is simple one too. Let me check here. Let me start, okay, employee, yeah, employee ID 1, employee ID 3, okay, here we go, employee, session dot get, employee dot class, ID is 1, it returns object, typecast it to employee. So employee dot get employee ID, employee dot get employee name, employee dot get employee address, employee dot get salary. Okay, get salary we go first. Now here look at this address part. Address equals to, yeah. Employee dot get address. Then using that, I call all the same methods. Address ID, to be the door number get state city door number state street get zip code right. So look at the way the output gets printed. Expected java.lang. I want you guys to observe this output. Employee ID, employee name, employee salary, address ID, city, door number, state, state, zip code. What did I do? Did I call get employee and also did I call get address? I just said get employee, but along with the employee, I also got the data from address table. Did I wrote any join? Did I use any join condition? Or did I write a query to join query? So what is happening? This is the power of your Hibernate. You don't need to write any join statements. It automatically does the joining for you. It automatically fetches the data from all the dependent tables. So when I am fetching for employee, it also fetches in which address the employee stays. That is what happening. Look at this. If you look at the console and you observe carefully, this guy has constructed a query, right? And that query is a join query action. It's a huge big query. Why? Why does huge big query? Because it's a join query. Because there is an employee table. There is an employee table. There is also an address table. So it has to fetch the data from both the tables. It has to fetch the data from both the tables. So when you say get of employee, you are not only fetching the employee record, employee data from employee table, you are also fetching the data from address table. And this is called as eager fetching. This is called as eager fetching. This is called as eager fetching. This is called eager fetching. Fetch equal to fetch type dot eager. I run it again. See. Now this is eager fetching. Now I have one more option. What is that one more option is, instead of eager fetching, why don't you write your lazy? By default it is eager. By default it is eager. Then you did lazy fetching. Observe. This is your previous output. Now you see the difference in the output here. What happened? There are two times SQL query, right? So the first query is only to fetch the data from employee table. Then second query is to fetch the data from address table. So what happens is, you need to observe the code for this. So when you say first get of employee, because you specified fetch type as what, lazy, it only fetched the employee details and you printed the details. You printed the details. But the moment you say get address, when fetch type is lazy, right, it invokes SQL again. When the fetch type is lazy, when you say get address, that's the reason when you see the output. When I say get address, it is fetching what for you? So you have the option. If you say lady, then when you say get address, then it will write a SQL query to get the address from the address table. But if you don't say fetch type lazy, then it will construct a join query and it gets the data at one go only. It gets all the data in the beginning. It fetches all the data in the beginning itself. So I go back and change it to here, eager, lazy to eager. Now you see this output. Because it has constructed a very a join query to fetch the complete data. Is it clear or any questions on this part? So I discussed one-to-one, I discussed many-to-one, then I spoke about eager fetching, and I also spoke about the lazy loading. So you guys have any questions or is it clear? Okay. See, it's not that okay. We'll do Hibernate to HTML. It's gonna be very simple thing. All right. What you're gonna do is, if you go back to your server, I will be demonstrating one example. I'll give you one example. May not be able to discuss it in the class, but I'll of course help you with one example. See, it's very simple. What exactly the only changes will be there, right? You still have your connection, you still have your controller, you still have your DAO. You got this DAO, user DAO. In this user DAO, you have this programs, insert, update, delete. Instead of these programs, of course you'll have insert, update, delete. Within this insert, update, delete, what are you doing? You are writing some JDBC logic, right? Instead of JDBC logics, you will be writing Hibernate logic. That is the only change if you want to use Hibernate. If you want to use Hibernate with a servlet, everything will remain the same. The only thing which gets changed is DAO program. What it gets changed is not the method names, whatever you have written inside the method name, right? Hey, now what you do is, you got your insert method here. You got your insert method. Simple. Within this insert method, you take session dot save. That's it. The job is done. So the only program which gets changed is DAO program. And that too, what changes? The 30 lines of JDBC code will be replaced by a single line of Hibernate code. So it's very easy, and I'll help you with one of the examples. So it's not a challenge, it's very, very simple task. So guys, so far you saw this one, one-to-one and many-to-one. Let's come here. Let me discuss another scenario. Many-to-many and one-to-many. I'll be discussing many-to-many, then you can work it out one-to-many. So the best example for many-to-many is this. Student ID, student name, course ID, course name. Student ID, student name, course ID, course name. One, Arun. One, C. this seems to be fine. Now Arun want to enroll for C as well as C++. Arun want to enroll for C as well as C++. I cannot do this. This is not allowed, because according to your first normal form, actually this is a database term. According to your first normal form, a particular column should have a unique value. You cannot have something like this. It is a multi-value, right? A column cannot take multiple values. It should have a single value, single atomic value. This is what your first normal form says. It should be atomic. Then, what should I do for this? Then will I be doing this? 1, Arun, C++. You are duplicating your employee data here. So this is not allowed. This is not allowed. So will I be putting it here? Arun enrolled for this. Arun enrolled for this. Oh, Kiran also did this. So what do you think? This is allowed. This is also not allowed. The solution is, you end up in creating one more table called student_course table. You end up in creating one more table called student_course table. Student 1, course 1. Student 1, course 2. Student 2, course 1. So this is a table which maintains a relationship. This is a table which maintains a relationship. So if it is a JDBC, you need to create three tables. You have to do this table. You also have to do this table. If it is a JDBC, you end up in creating the tables. You end up in creating three tables. Whereas in Hibernate, if you observe carefully, here, see the advantage and see the power of the Hibernate. I have a student.java, I have a course.java. Now there is an advantage of Hibernate is, if you know the student ID, you can know what courses it joined. If you know the course ID, you can find out who all the students joined. So it's a bi-directional thing, right? Student ID can help you with how many courses he joined. Whereas your course ID can help you with how many students enrolled for it. Course ID can tell you how many students enrolled for it. Student ID can tell you how many people joined for the course. Sorry, student ID can tell you how many courses he joined. Course ID can tell you how many students enrolled for the course. Right. So it's a bi-directional. From the student ID you can find out how many courses he joined. And from the course ID you can find out how many students joined for that course. So it should be bi-directional. So here I'm doing bi-directional also. So if I know the student ID, I can also get the course details. What courses he joined. If I know the course ID, I can tell you how many students joined for this course. So there is a @ entity, there is a @ table, and there is a ID for course ID, and there is a column. There is a ID, and there is a column. And similarly, student table also, @ entity, @ table. There is an ID, there is a column, right? And you need to focus here. What I have? I have a set of courses. Why I have a set of courses? Normally, if you look at your last example, you just did this. Address. But I'm not doing course. I'm doing what? Collection of courses. What I'm doing here? I'm doing a collection of courses. I'm doing what? I'm doing a collection of courses. I'm doing a collection of courses. So that's the reason I have a set. Then I have a get course set and I have a set course set. On top of this getter method, you need to understand here, this is what very important. You don't have a single course object. You have a multiple course object here. You have a collection of courses because student can enroll for more than one course. Student can enroll for more than one course. Now on top of this get method, you are writing @ many to many. You are writing what? @ many to many. That is, each student can enroll for many courses. And there should be a third table which gets generated, right? A third table gets generated. So here I'm specifying. What is your join table? The join table is student_course. So what are the columns you are joining? What are the columns you are joining here? You are joining student ID from student table, course ID from course table. I'm saying your join column, student ID, inverse join column, that is the column from another table, course ID. And I want it bidirectional, right? If I know the student ID, I also need the course details. So this is direction from student to course. This is direction from student to course. Now here you need to take one more step. Look at this. In the course table you have a get student set, because each course can be enrolled by many students. Each course can be enrolled by many students. So you have a set of students. You have a get method and set method, and you are writing @ many to many, and you are specifying @ join table, student_course, same table name what you gave here. Then your join column is what? Course ID is join column. Inverse join column is what? Student ID. If you look at the previous one, join column was student ID, inverse join column was course ID, because you are in the student table. Now in the course, join column is course ID, inverse join column is student ID. Now what is the advantage of specifying this? Guys, understand, even if you don't specify this join table, it works. Even if you don't specify this join table, it works. But what is the drawback of it is, if you don't specify join table, then you get one more table also. If you don't use a join table annotation, this is what happens. If you don't use the join table annotation, this is what gonna happen. Course ID 1, student 1. Course ID 1, student 2. Right, course ID 2, student 1. So what happens is, if you don't specify this join table annotation, then you get 4 tables totally. One table to store the student data, another table to hold the course data. One is holding the relationship between the student and the course, other one is holding the relationship between the course and the student. Then why did I specify join table? Because when I'm specifying the join table, I'm specifying the table name student course. And here also I specify the table name student course. Since I specify the table name, so understand here, when I use @ join table annotation, I'm specifying the table name, name equal to. So since I specified a table name, what happened? It is not creating two tables for you. Since I am using the join table annotation, it is not creating two tables, because while specifying the join table, you are specifying the name of the table, and you kept the name of the table in both the places same. So instead of generating two tables, it generates only one table. If you don't use @ join table annotation, then what happens? Totally 4 tables get created, but 4 tables are of no use for me. For me, 3 tables are good enough. So in order to restrict from 4 to 3, I use this annotation @ join table through which I restricted the tables to what? Only three. Through which I restricted the tables to what? Only three. Now let me run this. And you are familiar with all the rest of the options. First, let me save the records. And you need to understand here what I'm doing. You have two course objects and you have two student objects. Oh, there are three course objects. There are three course objects and two student objects. Then you have a set, and to the set you are adding all the courses. To the set you are adding the courses, and to the students you are adding the course set. That is, you are enrolling here you added course 1 to set. You added course 1 to set. You added course 2 set. You added course 3 to also set. Now here you are enrolling student for all three courses. Same. You are enrolling student for all three courses. So student 1 also joined three courses. Student 2 also joined three courses. You are saving the students. Commit. Now I run this code. You see the SQL statements here. Right? There are four, right? There are two courses and two students. So you have the sequences. So there are three courses, two students. So there are five IDs auto generated. So you inserted a student, you inserted the three courses. You inserted a student. Alright? So two students inserted, three courses got inserted. But I should also insert the data into the third table, right? See, first I added one record here, then I added three courses here. If you look at that, that is what you have. First student you added, after adding the first student, then you added three courses. So I added Arun, then I added three courses. Then I added second student. After adding the second student, look at this. Student underscore 6 records are there. Because you are enrolling every student for three courses. So student 1 enrolled for course 1. Student 1 enrolled for course 2. Student 1 enrolled for 3. Then 2 enrolled for 1. 2 enrolled for 2. And 2 enrolled for 3. That's what happened. So this is first insert query. This is next three insert queries. This is your fourth insert query, fifth insert query. So first student, then courses, then student, then you are inserting into student underscore course table. Now in case if you want to do it the same thing with JDBC, you could have written how much of logic. But here it's very simple. So you just have the course objects, you have the student objects, and you just need to say save student 1 and save student 2. That's it. Your job is done. When you say save student 1 and save student 2, for you it seems like, you know, you are calling only two functions. But here how many queries got executed? How many? These are 6 and 7, 10, 11 queries almost got executed. 11 insert queries executed. Now as I said, right, if I get the student, I get the course details. Look, I'm trying to fetch the student. I change your CFD to update. Now if you look at this, I'm trying to fetch what? I'm trying to fetch student details. But along with the student details, you're also fetching the course details also. Let's check whether I have a student ID 1 or not. Student 1, he enrolled for C programming, he also enrolled for C++ programming, he also enrolled for Java. So when you know the student ID, you can also know what all the courses he joined to. But it's unidirectional, right? I will show you the bidirectional also. See. Now I know the course ID. I'm trying to see how many students are enrolled for this course. I know the course ID. I'm trying to see how many students are enrolled for this course. C is a course. 1 is also enrolled, Arun. 5 is also enrolled, Kiran. So that is the significance of your bidirectional. But whenever you, if you don't use @ annotation, if you don't use @ join table annotation, then you end up in creating 4 tables. Now instead of creating 4 tables, you are creating only 1. Because of the annotation @ join table, and when you specified the table name and you kept the table name in both the places same, so there is only 1 table generated instead of 2. So any questions on this part? Is it simple or clear? Is it simple, or do you have any questions for me? Alright guys, okay. Somebody in the series. Alright. Okay, so just work around with these examples. I'll also share one more example which involves Hibernate and servlets. And I'll do the same activity using servlet JDBC. And the similar activity I'll also do it with the servlet Hibernate, and I'll share it with you folks. As I said, right, only the DAO program gets changed, rest of the programs will remain same. Okay. So, any questions for me? Alright. If no questions, I would like to stop here. We'll catch you in the next session. And tomorrow we're gonna get started with Spring Framework. I'm done with Hibernate part, okay? So tomorrow we're gonna get started with Spring Framework. So I want you guys to go through these examples and come up with any questions before I get started with Spring. I'll look into that. Just give me some minute. All right, guys. Thank you, everyone. Catch you in the next session.